Hello, good afternoon. Last year, Jens Olof Pedersen and from DTU Space and myself, we published an article in Energy and Environment. Yes. Hello, hello. Testing 1, 2, 3. Oh, that was better. That was better. I have a long mouth. Okay.
Is that
any better? I can shout a little. Then it will be shorter. And our article was called "Temperature Trends with Reduced Impact of Ocean Air Temperatures." And before I forget, I just put. I will tell you this right away. The toughest part of this work was to obtain original temperature data. We have contacted around 20, 30 meteorological institutes around the world, asked for, please share your original temperature data with us from A to Z, and we probably did get no help from anywhere. So, coming up, I'll just check this thing here. Oh, yeah, basic concept, what am I going to tell you? And then we have a lot of results, so it's going to be just a little fast overview. And then the impacts, possible impacts, how does our findings affect how to adjust temperatures? A little side note on sulfur aerosol cooling. And how should we use and not use global temperatures, conventional global temperatures? And then why not speak about the main results? Some thoughts about these and some alternative explanations for what our findings. If we have the time, maybe we can go on to show you some calculations. Peer reviewers want that. So. Okay. This, as you can see, is obviously a piece of land. And here is a thermometer, so we are now measuring land temperature. So that is basically the point that we have today, a concept of ocean temperatures and land temperatures, but it's kind of nonsense. We should do better than that. And to get on the same page, we can see in the continental, we have generally hotter summers than in the coastal environment, with the coastal winds coming in, and in the continental environment, winters are colder than coastal winters. So, and this is of course because coastal temperatures are tied very much to the ocean temperatures. And of course, any period of more or less heating of the Earth generally is best reflected from such stations here. We call them ocean air affected and ocean air sheltered. I'm going to repeat these abbreviations 500 times. So I think at some point you will follow me. So here is our heroic thermometer. And I think I can now say that is very impacted by ocean temperature. Mostly perhaps the parameter called marine air temperatures, because it's the marine air that is generally blowing in from west over Europe. So many people could have an idea, okay, how long inside the continent would we be able to find temperature trends that are affected by the ocean air? Would it be 500 meters? Would it be 500 kilometers? And we don't have to speculate and be geniuses. We simply just look at data, how long into the land can we trace the same temperature as we can trace at the coast. And at some point, we also would like to know where is actually then the real land temperature, the ultra land temperature, and where. And of course, how does this ultra land temperature that is where we have really reduced the ocean impact, how does that look? And what does it tell us? So here we have Central Europe again. Some people say that US have more long temperature stations than Europe has. I do not agree. Every flag here is from a temperature station, and the colors represent different warming temperature rise after the warm peak 1930 to 50. And we can see that the trends we found at the ocean here, they seem to survive quite a bit into the land area. On the other hand, if we look at the mountain valleys here in Central Europe, it's quite clear that we see the much, much, much colder trends in the mountain valleys. Far most of stations, temperature stations in general, are placed in valleys and not on mountain tops, because people historically wanted to know what was the weather where they lived. And we also have a little example over here, same picture, Northeast USA, same picture. Can you see some kind of systematic distribution between those flags? If you think you can, you cannot. Because only if you are publicly funded climate expert, you will be able to see a trend. Everybody else are complete, cannot speak about anything. So this is the sort of system. There are actually more effects, but this is a primary effect I just want to show you. We have the wind coming in from the ocean and the coastal trends that seems to reappear wherever the winds from the ocean have a direct first hit on some hillside facing the oceans, or hilltops, mountains, so on. We have trends in Tibet that looks like the Indian coast, for example. And there's the lovely abbreviation again, OAA, ocean air temperature affected areas, and the ocean air shelter. This is a map also, Central Europe. We see the nitrogen dioxide distribution that's pouring out from the metropoles. And what we see is that in the same mountain areas, it's not so much. And this just gives a little clue that this air up here, that would also be our ocean air, for example, is not really having a easy time getting into this valley. So, first set of results, you're going to see a lot of results. I'm sorry. This is based on, like, I think around 400 stations or something. The red one is the ocean air affected. The blue one is the ocean air sheltered, typically from valleys, deep valleys. And what we see is that all over Europe, the valleys seem to speak the same language, that we have a heat period here, large, long-lasting heat event here in the 19 to 30 to 50 period, that seems to have temperatures that resemble modern-day temperatures. On the other hand, all the coastal stations, they blatantly fail to show this very well-documented heat event. And again, the logic would probably be that ocean temperatures are tied, these stations, ocean air affected, are tied to upper ocean layer temperature developments, rather than the heating, the actual heating of the Earth at some point in the past. So what we see is that the oceans are heating slowly and delayed, and the ocean data is not good for measuring the heating of the Earth. Just here, I made some comparisons. German OAA data, for example, these have a very nice fit with the Netherlands ocean air affected data. And why would I show you that? Because that is obvious they would have. Because the Dutch data comes from one data treatment for a long time, and the German comes from another data treatment with other people's other procedures. But still, they give the same result, and it gives a feeling that these data seems useful. So, Northeast USA, same picture, ocean air data, slowly warming up, does not reflect the heat event here, which the valleys can reflect without noise from ocean air temperatures. And so we did 16 areas, 10 of which were published last year, and the last six probably will be published in the spring of 2020. I'll show you these two. And as you can see, we have a lot of the globe covered. Scandinavia. It's very wonderful to work with because there are so many stations. We have typically the wind coming in from the west here, western directions. So these data on the leeward side of the mountains, they have some shelter, but they're not always in shelter because sometimes the wind actually comes from the east. So this is more ocean air sheltered than these, but they're not perfect ocean air shelter. But still, we can see that the blue graph has basically no heating, and there is some warming in the ocean data. And now I'm going to go through a lot of areas a little quick. We have Siberia here, ocean data, central US Midwest. And this I find very nice because it's a Balkan, Hungary and Serbia mostly in this area. We can see that these trends are very, very similar to the neighboring area of Central Europe. I just showed you the same logic. Here, two Chinese valleys, perfect for this quest. And we get the same results. Quite markedly, actually. And Zimbabwe, Zambia area, South Africa, Pakistan, Sahel, and Southeast Australia. And again here, these OAS, ocean air shelter station, are not perfect because sometimes the wind can come in here. But obviously, there are more better ocean air shelter than these. And we can still see some difference in the trends, and there is basically no heat trend from the middle of the 20th century and forward. Paraguay, or rather Central South America, five nations of, giving very significant difference between the shelter station and the ocean station. Mexico, Turkey, and then Chile, which is a neighbor here. And we can see that Chile and the South Central America data are very, very similar. So these are the global results. I showed you a lot of very chaotic OAS graphs individually, but when you add the whole stuff together from the whole globe, you get this very, very nice, smooth, sine wave-like curve for the OAS data. And I think Alex Myrna said something about a 60-year period. Would that be correct? That's probably a coinciding, isn't it? Okay. And then the OAS data on the global scale. And again, the globe held together so we better can see the difference. We have the OAS from all over the globe. Everywhere there is a valley in protection from ocean temperature trends, we get confirmed that there was a global heating event in this period, which is extremely poorly reflected from the ocean data, which seems to be slowly getting warmer and warmer. So what does this the ocean air data, does this indicate the heating of the Earth? No, of course not. It just indicates how warm was the upper ocean at that time. And this is one of my darlings. Illogically, the OAA data should have some similarity to the marine air temperature, because it is marine air that floats in over the Earth. And so this is the official Hadcrot version of marine air temperature data, and the two graphs have the our graph, and their graph is rather similar. I will just show you a few of my data comparisons. Scandinavia versus Central Europe. You can see the sine wave shape, but you can see that the dotted Scandinavian data have much more variability than the Central Europe. And this is quite common, accepted that we have a phenomenon called Arctic amplification that always seems to enlarge temperature differences. And the same we can see here, it is on the north hemisphere. The light blue are all the air regions that are closest to the Arctic, and the dark blue are the regions that are closest to the equator. And again, we see the sine wave, but larger variation in the areas closer to the Arctic. The same we can actually also see in the ocean air data. And then also a funny one. I think it's funny, because I'm a nerd. Okay. That we have five regions from the Americas. Two of them are from southern hemisphere and three from the northern hemisphere. But nonetheless, they have a very similar, rather similar trend. So all these data seem to support each other. Maybe you could say that the Americas have some similarities, neighboring Pacific and a large rocky mountains and Andes mountains. So I would like to tell you first the sources of temperature data. It's mainly these two sources. If you notice that I have more data records, for example, from Europe, it's because we use meteorological yearbooks. And so if some in the coming slides you see that some data are missing, it's simply because we don't have that book. So it's not because there are holes in the data like that. And we also use the old NOAA GHCN version 2 raw. And now I would like to show you, first a little point. The OAS, the ocean air sheltered, the cold trended data, and the OAA, all, for each region, they all originate from the same source. So it's never the choice of source that explains the different trends. Same data source, but different trends. So, can start to conclude some things. This for me is very important. Any land area will have two different but correct temperature trends. This for me is a bomb. Because no well-known institution is adjusting or homogenizing data with respect to this. They always adjust to hit one expected trend. They don't accept that there are two. So basically, my bold claim is they're all doing it wrong. So here, just to show you what I'm talking about, the Northeast USA again. So let's say we have a valley station with a cold trend. You have to adjust this. If there is a reason to adjust, let's say a station move or something, you have to adjust such a station to look like the average trends of the similar stations. Never make such a station look like a warm-trended coastal station. And everybody does that error. And are we talking about small, marginal impacts? No. The red, the coastal, have a full global warming signal around 0.7 degrees after 1950. And the other ones has no warming signal at all, basically. So it means everything not to do this wrong. I will give you an example where it goes wrong, and I will not hide from you that I don't love this BEST stuff. BEST, just because they write it so clearly. Difference from regional expectation. Singular. Not two. And then they say, oh, there is this warm period, is in Hungarian graph. We're gonna have to adjust this thing so it matches what we would expect. And they usually expect something warm-trended. I've never seen anything else. So, OAS data, the cold-trended ones, the valid stations, they are typically ignored. So here you see a lot of temperature trends from around 1900 and till today. And all of them in Histel are shown with a rather continuous warm trend. There are none of these, there are not one that shows the warm peak I would expect from a valley station, an OAS station, because I meet this valley heat everywhere on the Earth. So here are some of their data from Histel, Austrian Meteorological Institute, and here's, you can see there is no warm. It's just, so I'm wrong, right? Because everything I've said about valley station, there should be a heat plop there. Well, here are the original data from this station. Each and every one has the historic heat exactly when expected, when considering what we find all over the world. The OAS data is simply ignored or removed with a lawnmower by the Austrians. Same data sets. I want to say I have many more original data sets from the Alps, just so you know. From GIS, NASA GIS, and here you can see GIS does the same trick, except in some cases they add even more heat trend. And then what I'm not so happy about is that when you choose to see this, the data from NASA GIS, and you pick the unadjusted ones, they don't show you that they have adjusted it even. And then BEST, as I said, I'm not so happy about this data set. They also don't show the actual measured data from the valleys. They remove it, and then they cut. They always do that a lot. They cut like an unhinged butcher, that's my feeling, all the data sets for some reason. And then they say boldly, we have so many data sets. That's great. And we use raw data. BEST raw. It is from their raw database. But isn't there any alpine temperature data that was not adjusted? Yes, there was. Now we go to the alpine mountain peaks, which is hit by ocean air. And suddenly you see brilliant agreement between the original data and the corrected data. In other words, they didn't change the data when it had this heat, continuous heat trend that they expected. We have two OAA stations here, and there is no changes of data. So what we can conclude is, on the top of mountains, we have good thermometers, we use data as they are. Bad thermometers in the valleys, cold trends, no good. So we change data or we deselect them. One more example, Scandinavia. So the blue data sets here are from meteorological yearbooks. Yes, I went to Sweden University, sit in the basement and took pictures, all the books, and plotted in the whole thing. And the red ones are what we can see online from the EU, partly EU-funded. I don't know if you know this, E-C-A-N-D, rather nice online utility, except that they don't show all the data. And I just don't understand what is going on in their minds when they think, hey, let's not show this, only show these. What is going on in their heads? I simply don't understand. These are 16 from Sweden. And here you have 16 more. Same situation. We simply remove the data. One more example still from Europe. Hungary. The Serb is not so funny because, for example, in Best, these OAS stations, they only use Belgrade with a lot of urban heat. All the others have been cut off from 1974 and then the urban heat station. Hungary, these are from meteorological yearbooks. And again, notice these drops just mean we haven't got access to that book and that book and that book. So we don't have all data. And need I say, if we had not worked with original data, we would not have been able to find all these warm peaks in the 1930-50 period. So actually from 1934 to around 1980, we see a very large drop in the majority, not all, for example, Budapest, not, but the majority of Hungarian stations show a rather large drop in this period, as we would expect from OAS stations. But in the so-called Best lovely collection from 1934 to 1980, it's not much. Maybe if we look at the one-year variation, it's a little decline here. But if we compare with the original, this is the average yearly data plotted in. Oh, that was a little fast. No, let's go to Denmark. Whatever. Denmark, here we have the winds coming in from west normally. And so these red areas with coastal, they are the most warm trended. And of course, Copenhagen with the urban heat island is also very warm trended. These five stations are what the Danish Meteorological Institute are using for the Danish contribution to the global temperature, like NASA and Hadcrot and so on. They use these. All warm. So I actually ask them in a mail, why do you do this? Why only take the warm trended ones? And they are asking me, it's because they are so continuous and nice and long. So not combine, it's not even correct because we have some here that are also very long. So better have stations that we know give the wrong result. Because they are long and continuous. Great. And here comes my darlings, Best. They have much more data. They have three of these, two of these, three of these, five of these, and three of these. Great. And we wonder, why do they replicate the previous known data? Just as a side note, because I happen to stand with these data from here and here, let's, do you know, we have an argument that the cooling from 1945 to 1975 is due to human-emitted sulfates, right? Okay. In this area here, PM10 is the particle matter up to a size around micron 10, which includes the sulfates from human emissions. And this area, we know there is a lot of sulfates. And again here, in this area, the air is slowly coming in and the sulfates are not surviving into the valleys. So, of course, the sulfate that is concentrated in the metropoles of the Earth, like New York, Central Europe, Beijing, and so on, they should have such a strong cooling effect that they can cool the entire globe. So we should really, really expect to see a massive cooling effect here. But there's nothing. Here we have the flat trend. And in the mountain valleys, where there are no sulfates, there we have the cooling. This is a little meme. It's up in the time to make a meme. Examine the stars. Reduce atmospheric air noise. Go to the mountain. Examine heating of the Earth. Reduce oceanic air noise. Go to the valley. Can we use global temperature to know the heating of the past? That is the question. Oh, and why even know the heating of the past? I'll try to formulate this. To evaluate the extent of CO2 heating, we normally start out by knowing the heating of the past at specific times. The OAS, the Valley Station, seems to do a fairly good job at this. For any specific time, we get a relatively good idea about the heating of the Earth because it's not too much ocean noise in the data. So we have, from around the globe, 16 areas were in agreement that we had this heating event where the ocean air just simply failed to show it. And the upper ocean data would be the ocean air affected, the marine air temperatures, and, of course, the sea surface temperatures. All these data sets are tightly connected with upper ocean data. And these three types of data, ocean, upper ocean data, they just tell us how far in the delayed warming of the upper ocean we have come. Plus, there can be internal variability in ocean, as we have heard today from Alex Mirner, if you saw this. So it can be a lot of complexity in ocean data. But the conventional global temperatures, they are around roughly 70% of this, and maybe around, just a guess, 10% of this. So it's completely dominated by ocean air temperatures. So the normal conventional temperature data is very connected to the type of data that simply cannot show the heating of the past. So what I'm saying is, these are global temperatures, you like. Global temperatures do show the heating, do not show the heating of the past well at any specific time in the past, because they're ocean dominated. So it's a very complex thing to go from an ocean data to say what was the heating at that time. Valley or ocean OAS temperatures are the best indicator of the heating in the past. We have, I'm not saying it's perfect at all, but it's certainly better than having a data set so strongly influenced by how warm the ocean has become at a certain time. So use valley OAS data, not global temperature, to evaluate the heating in general and CO2 heating. That's my opinion. So, what do these show? We know here that, we can see here that the heating from all these valleys show that the heating of the Earth in this period is similar to recent years. Okay. So why do we need a large CO2 heating component in model calculation to explain no extra heating after 1950? This is the human emission of CO2, and it explodes after 1950. But for some peculiar reason, this seems to have no effect on the temperatures measured all over the world where the temperatures are not full of ocean noise. So maybe some of you are thinking, well, But still, why was it that CO2 warming don't work so much in valleys all over the world where ocean air temperatures cannot dominate the trends? I don't know. But we have some other explanation. I've received, because these results were published, most of them a year ago, and I was actually expecting a storm, like, it was the most read article in this paper, Energy and Environment, so I was expecting a lot of heat, I was saying that. So I was really open to hear suggestions from all over the world, but have only got these two from people that seems really dedicated to. Then one of them says that human-emitted aerosol sulfates is the reason, although most of our data are collected from the remote places like Siberia and South America, where there is no sulfate aerosols, and the controversial part of the data are these, and they are from the valleys where there are certainly no sulfate aerosols. And then the windmills also. Have a guy that really thinks it's the windmills. I tried to tell him, but there are no windmills in Siberia. Come on. My personal position, to be a little compromise thing, I think that at least this finding needs further investigation. And I think I would hope that they would be taken serious so we could get better data and be more sure about the conclusions. What is the time?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. So, we are in the peer review process, and we were asked to do some calculation. Do you remember the map of Europe with all the blue cold-trended stations in the valleys and the red warm-trended stations near the coast? And the peer reviewers had a lot of things he wasn't happy about. But one thing is, he said, you need to make a calculation, because I'm sure that if somebody else come, he would make it the other way around or something. But we didn't really do anything. We just show the cold trended are in the valleys, etc. But nonetheless, we started this. So for each temperature station, we use the wind power in 12 different directions. For each direction, we have to evaluate what is the shelter in that direction, how far is it away, and how far are we from the ocean, and then we make different parts of this calculation, put together in one direction, and then sum for 12. And when we have made 4,000 evaluations, we can make one graph. So there went that summer up in smoke. So we made this graph. The OAS factor that we calculated means the higher number means we have a bigger shelter. It's a more strong ocean air sheltered station. The lower number means there is hardly any shelter at all. And we can, so far, we cannot make account. Wind is a complex thing. It can turn and twist around mountains and so on. We cannot, in a simple rough formula, account for everything. But we can see that we are content with this, that we see very low OAS factor, meaning we have not any shelter, corresponds with all the temperature trends from the coast, and the cold trended has a lot of shelter. Does it make sense? More shelter by calculation means cooling trend. So we hope they will be happy now. So what did I tell you to summarize? I have to repeat this because I find it so important. All land areas has two correct temperature trends. So this is something that people that adjust temperatures should start considering. And then we had the little side note about the aerosol cooling and the valley OAS temperatures more suited to evaluate heating of the Earth than global temperatures. That's my opinion. And if tomorrow comes a smart guy and say, hey, you missed that point or this or that, I will change my opinion. But this is just how it looks right now. The heating of the Earth's valleys in this period is similar to this period, 60 years roughly in between. And I cannot see, if I hadn't heard in the media that CO2 was a big warming agent in the atmosphere, from these days I would never have gotten that idea. Have you seen this one before? I have two requests. We need to have funded an independent, truly independent, not like BEST, truly independent global surface temperature data set. I have asked Jens Olaf Pepke at DTU Space about it a few times. It would be so nice. DTU Space, global temperatures, wouldn't that be nice? And also, all original temperature data must be shared by meteorological institutes immediately, because we have really worked hard and we could have saved years of work if they had just shared. That's it.